Oh yeah, got it. And it's quite the opposite. The emphasis will be on ball lightning modeling, but we want to be realistic about this, and so we start out with the real world. The book you see here was also mentioned by Professor Bischoff. I noticed the reference to the same author. And from this book, I have selected a case which is important for my the model I will develop down below. This picture you see is a drawing in this book, which does give the structure of the ball lightning. Professor Nikitin was also talking about what the structure of ball lightning is. Well, it is it can have many appearances, and one of them is this. And I selected it because there is this expression about the structure, and the observer on the right describes the structure as the light of the ball lightning was wriggling like a mass of eels. This is the description that this observer has given of this ball lightning event, which you can find in the book by Corliss. Then a similar observation in we need two witnesses to be really credible. There is another eyewitness who was observing the ball lightning in his garden. And again, it was rather normal, the size 2 feet, pale blue green color, 3 seconds, and explosive decay with damage on our house. For case one, the sentence that touches on my presentation is a vibrating mass of strips of light in rapid rolling motion. This is important for my talk. My talk will deal on, not with the variety of properties, but just with two ball lightnings, really. Ball lightning observations, really. The second description is the balls seem to be made of a mass of writhing strings of light. That's the sentence that you can find in these observations. Case one is in a weather magazine, and case two is in the book which you've seen. Now I come to a recent observation, which is the very opposite of the ones I showed previously. It was made in a French plane, the Dassault Falcon 20 jet plane, and it was reported in 2006. And now the sentence, the description from the observer is very different. What it is described as a perfect ball. And this word perfect ball is not only Neurath's observation, it also occurs in a report by Professor Roger Jennison. He was also an observer of ball lightning inside an aircraft. It was a commercial aircraft, and the Jennison observation is 4 decades before New World. But both observers describe the ball as a perfect, the ball lightning as a perfect ball without any structure. And this is not what I have seen in the lecture by Professor Bishkov. Now, I stay in the real world. The first few slides are from the real world. And this real world data from Japan. It is a paper in Nature. It is recent, 2017. And it reports on observations at a power station in Japan. Detection equipment was installed for high energy photons. And the power station Kashiwazaki Kariba in Japan was located on the sea. It was 24-hour in operation. At some point, a thunderstorm passed. This is a thunderstorm above sea passed. And the detection system detected high energy radiation at several frequencies, but very clearly at 0.511 MeV, which is characteristic of annihilation of electrons and positrons. So the lightning does produce high energy radiation, and these on this report by Enoto in 2017 proves this. It's a fact of life. Then before that, earlier on, there were reports on the high energy radiation from natural lightning. It came from an Indian station, Gulmarg Cosmic Ray Station, same procedure as in Japan. There was a 24-hour operation of detection, but it was detection of neutrons. Neutrons as from fusion reactions of deuterium in R. The station reported twice. In 1985, it had already reported neutron counts. And in 2016, the new report about gamma radiation occurred. Even before that, two English scientists had reported on a connection between gamma radiation and lightning. They installed again automatic equipment, 24-hour operation, and they checked the data after a year. It was, I think, 9-month operation. Also, they found 4 high energy events. Again, the spectrum counter told them it was the 511 keV radiation that India later on found. And one of those events was recorded during a thunderstorm, which they checked with the local weather station. This is Ashby and Whitehead, UKEA column, again, well known in England. Now I turn to modeling this event. On my image, there's some signs that are not correct, and this will happen a lot, but I think I can still fill those gaps. The clock that you see is three, it means definitions. If you see that clock, there is the sign for F is defined as. So there is two definitions up on this slide and in the top, and there is two definitions in the lower half of the matrices that you see. Then the downward thumb is the capital delta, and it is the determinant. It's the determinant of the both matrices. Then the top matrices are well known. They are the field matrices for the electromagnetic field. And the little one is the submatrix, the minor of the capital F. On the lower matrices are my definitions. I have not found them in any electromagnetic book. So I, those are authoritative books, Landau, Lifshitz, Jackson, don't find them. If you compare the signs in the capital F and the capital P, you will find the same distribution of signs. It makes both matrices anti-symmetric. You can see that the F matrix has six variables, and the P matrix, which is for potential, actually F is for field matrices and P is for potential matrices. Again, I have been unable to find them in any electromagnetic book. Now, the P matrices have four variables. And they have the signs, the signature is makes them a quaternion matrix. If you organize the electromagnetic field this way, with phi as electrostatic potential and A as magnetic vector potential, and you have the signs the way you see in this matrix, it will be a definition of quaternion space. This physics is taking place in quaternion space. And you can see that at the matrices, because the matrices are positive, or the P, capital P matrix is positive or zero. The P matrix, the P determinant is zero or positive by all the squares that you see and the dot product. It means that the matrix P is invertible. And it is, so it means that you are dealing with an with quaternion space, with you're dealing with invertible matrices, and this is a severe restriction, and then you have the quaternion space. Now the quaternions were discovered by Hamilton in the 19th century. Here again, the clocks are means definitions. You get from the previous matrices, you get elementary matrices when you differentiate them by the potential or the components of the vector potential. This will give you unit, elementary unit matrices, and the unit matrices that give just the relations that Hamilton found and scratched on this bridge somewhere in Ireland, in, near Dublin. Then, okay, this, so my paper will work with potentials, electric potential and a magnetic vector potential by the regular definitions, phi defines the electric field E, and A defines the magnetic field B, just the same. Now I come to something else that I do not find in any book that is known to me or paper. If you want to do calculus, you will need a well-posed mathematical problem. Otherwise, you cannot do a calculus. There are 16 partial derivatives. If you work in four-dimensional space, which is where quaternions live, then you have 16 partial derivatives. You have four variables. The potential matrix has four variables. So you need to find 12 relations to have a well-posed problem. You see these 12 relations in the middle with gradient, rotation, moment, and eigenvalue. That was when I found these when I was working in Eindhoven in the math department, and when I was teaching mathematics at freshman classes only freshman classes. But those four, the gradient is three relations, the rotation is three, the moment, note that it does not have derivatives in it. It has the vector potential, not its derivative. And there is an eigenvalue equation. You can check this. When you check this by making projections, you can do projections on three faces. Then you will get the familiar Cauchy-Riemann rules that you use for complex mapping. These formula you see for gradient, rotation, and moment eigenvalue, you can, I gave inductive proofs for them. Inductive proofs for these 12 relations I published in the ESA, at an ESA conference at Versailles in 2008. Now, I see that this formula is a finger in it, and the finger means hell. I don't think I know what this finger means. This hand, anyway. There is a step away from the normal quaternions. The rules you see now, the eigenvalues, eigenvectors, chirality, are all real numbers. We are not working in complex plane. I think I will not say more than that. There is some changes in the P matrix I showed, and then you get real eigenvalues. This is only one. There are four eigenvectors, of course, and this is one. And you can see it's all real numbers. And here is the new item, is chirality. These, you will see it later on, what the consequences are in the pictures. But this chirality means that you get swirling solutions from this scheme, from this potential matrix. Now I can do a function theory thanks to these Cauchy-Riemann type equations. We can do potential. We can do calculus, and we can do mappings with it. And of course, I start out with an easy one, an important one that forms a sphere. This inversion map forms a sphere from a lattice. The lattice that you see has octahedral symmetry, and I have dressed it, the flux tubes, with a chiral surface, because you can make them turn all together. You can show that the matrices tubes with the chiral surface are worm wheels. They are worm wheels that can rotate together. Then with the inversion map, I can confine them in a sphere, but it is clear that in this sphere, this would not look like a perfect sphere at all. So what we are after is a mapping starting from the quaternion matrix I showed, which will give us the perfect sphere that the two witnesses talked about. I did some more complicated maps. I tried to find maps that will result in a sphere, and it is possible. I start from the complex plane in the left picture. And then I do not use the chirality. I knock out chirality, and you see the white lines are characteristics. And the characteristics are for the electric field and the magnetic field. Then when I switch on the chirality, you can see that the field lines start swirling. I'm still on the plane in the middle panel. But I can also map this picture on a sphere, and then I get something, I get the field lines that go on the sphere, and in this case, with this map that I make now, you see I model it, the nested flux loops. It's saying all of them are loops. They know where they intersect, and it is a perfect sphere. But there is one shortcoming there. The field lines are not equally spaced. So this will not give uniform pressure on the sphere, because flux tubes have a force which tries to shorten them. The flux is an elastic, consider it as an elastic flux tube. And if you want to stretch it, you have to do work on it. And it can do work for you by getting shorter. But I want a spherical solution, perfect like this one, but with the field lines equally spaced. I'm back at the real world for a moment. And this is a detail of the Japanese data on high energy production, radiation, and radio activity in the thundercloud. The nuclear process, I try to give it here, but here the this is too soon. I return. The nuclear process is a transition from nitrogen isotope 14 to nitrogen isotope 13 to carbon isotope 13. And the one below there is beta minus, it is electron plus positron ending up as two gamma photons, also from Enoto. Then there is a very surprising step. If you can look to the right panel of this slide, I took this picture from a long article published by W. Lee and seven others. It is an international team with Finnish, it's American-led, but there is also a Finnish scientist involved. It's 2018 now. The paper Skirmion State really deals with bosons. And the boson, the Skirmion, is a bosonic state of ultra cold atoms. And then the atoms get bosonic properties, and they can form a condensate. But this paper also gives a reference to a book article that was published with Professor Nikitin and Professor Bishkov and myself. And it is, I think it is referenced too in this paper. They refer to ball lightning, because the picture here also shows magnetic field lines and electric field lines at the same time. This is what happened in this bosonic condensate, which is made from atoms at extremely cold temperatures, laser-cooled atomic clouds, really. And the properties are that the magnetic field lines are linked. That's the top. The top one is the electric field. The lower is the electric, is the top one is the magnetic field, the loops, and they are linked with one another. And the lower one is the electric field. And you see that it does have a swirl. It has the kind of swirl that I found from my quaternion solutions. But you can also see that there is the pole is a singularity. The pole is north and south pole is a singularity. But I want to have this perfect sphere from the quaternion solutions. And this shows how I got them for the quaternion fields that I use. At the left, you see a double, it's a loop that you see. It's wound on a cylinder, but it has an upward going. It's a characteristic, of course, because it's a quaternion solution, it's a characteristic. It had the red color, the current or the magnetic field goes upward, and in the blue part it goes downward. The same is and by the way, it's not only for electrodynamics, but it's also for vorticity, because that has the same corresponding formulas as electrodynamics. But I'm doing only the electromagnetic field now. In the right panel itself, the same. And now I am content because the flux, the loop, these swirling flux loop, spreads evenly over the surface. It means that everywhere the force is has the same strength. Magnetic energy of energy density is the same everywhere on the surface, and then you will get also uniform pressure on this sphere. It also is a canonical form because you only need sines and cosines to make this picture. And that's enough for making it a canonical solution. Now, I look to other functions that have this property that on the surface, the energy density from this spiraling loop is constant. At the left panel, this is my made it because I want to model the moment that the discharge, lightning discharge, is formed at the lower cloud base. And the lower cloud base has a space charge spread over it. And of course, there are also currents because there is convection in vertical direction. It means there are also flux loops. And my idea about one way of making a lightning is that a flux loop gets wound up in the lightning channel in this way. And this one is, I choose this one because it starts from Huygens Tractrix. It's very early analytic solution of mechanics. Huygens Tractrix is rotated about the vertical axis. And then it is called the pseudosphere as a surface. It is the pseudosphere. And if you make a section through the plane, through the vertical axis, then it is the Huygens Tractrix. That's winding this way, you will need an external force. Otherwise, it will not happen. You need an external force. But there is an other way to get uniform distribution over in a plane. And you see it in the right panel. And now I use some mathematics that Italian mathematician Peano discovered. Except he did that with line elements. I have done it with arcs. But the basic idea is you start from a circular flux loop, and then you stretch it in discrete steps. You stretch it the way it is shown there. And in that way, you also increase the energy of this flux loop. It gets longer, so the work has to be done on it. And then the Peano process is made in such a way that you do not get intersections. And you will see that the distances between the arcs is everywhere the same. So you get the cancellation of the magnetic fields, and what is left is the electric fields. This is the Peano process, but it's the planar version of it. Now, I return to the ball lightning event that was formed on the window of the jet plane. In the jet plane, the observer saw corona discharge, severe corona discharge. And I want to model with this quaternion functions, with this calculus, the formation process on the window of this aircraft, on this jet plane. So, and to do that, I start with, it's more advanced in mathematics. I use Bessel functions, and it's an enormous topic. It's enormous interest for engineering. It's a very high development because it is used extensively in engineering and mechanical engineering and a lot of others. I want to show some properties of these spherical Bessel functions. Actually, they are the easiest ones of all Bessel functions that you find in these voluminous books about it, because you need only two sine functions to describe them. They are the difference between two sine functions. So and the other, the Bessel functions are the normal ones are series, infinite series of sine and cosine functions, not these spherical ones. Each picture is made by only two sines or cosines. And what I just want to show is when first we go to the complex plane, and then the Bessel function gets a real and an imaginary argument. I have calculated them separately and plotted them. And if you look at these pictures, you see the lowest order at the left, and the consecutive ones have a higher order. And I want to see if they are well behaved, if there is solutions which do not have infinities. It is possible, but they are rare. Only the left panel has no divergences. If you go to the right successively, you get more complicated graphs with much more divergences. In fact, the three of them, all of them show divergences, and things get worse. In the end, even there is no zero anymore in the rightmost panel. Okay. Now I move on to the complex plane, and then again, I can't find some Bessel functions that have no singularities. That's the top row is the easiest solution. So, still have no singularities. But if you look at the modified variety on the middle row, then there is all of them have this singularity at the origin. And that means that one of these fields that they describe is becoming infinite, which has its problems, of course. But the infinities are hard to suppress in these Bessel functions. Now I come to the quaternion Bessel function, which I wanted, which I found for the formation of the ball lightning on the wind under the window pane on this aircraft. It is a potential surface, and you see successive panels. And the sheet you see is the zero potential surface. And you see it is first only a small hill, and then it grows and it really forms this perfect sphere in the end on the rightmost panel. So I find that I can model with quaternion functions, quaternion Bessel functions, the formation on this of the ball in this Dassault Falcon 20 jet plane. Now I will say something about the experiments which we are doing. We use a coil with channels in it. The channels can be axial ones, left top or radial, and then you can wind a coil of it. This is what we do at our experiments. Then here I go back for a moment to the picture that shouldn't be there. I discussed it already. So we've make in these coils in real life. We're back in the real world now. And here is a coil winding machine. And the final state of this coil, when it is delivered, it's a coil from Litz wire. And the nice thing about it that you can easily calculate the properties, the length of it, and other important properties you can calculate, because again, this coil is wound, and it follows sine waves. It's all sine or cosine waves. This, I come to my conclusion. I have a quaternion model for a force-free ball lightning, and we obtain from it the fields are, we find radial electrofield distributions which serve for self-confinement. This is like swearing in a church, as we say, for the people that do magnetohydrodynamics, but this is what I find for ball lightning. Then formation, I have calculated from corona discharge on aircraft window in a thunderstorm. I find that this reversible, that the ball lightning can store reversible energy in bosonic flux loops. And the present challenge of atmospheric science for me is, can the nuclear regime become steady? And I believe it can. Thank you for your attention.
Okay.